الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise is due to Allah alone, and may peace and blessings be upon our messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his family and his companions. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another episode of the basics of a Muslim's belief. So after mentioning the name Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the name Ar-Rabb, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord. And the second indication of the importance of this name is that if we look at the dua of the prophets throughout the Quran, what do we see the majority of the dua of the prophets being made with? Rabbana. And there are books you can get called or authored about Rabbana, authored about all of the du'as that begin our Lord. I think there is a mention of somewhere around the number of 40 in the Quran, or perhaps more than that in the Quran, that mention the word Rabbana, our Lord, in terms of a du'a that was made or that we are commanded to make from the prophets or from the pious people. And I want to ask you a question that I want you to think about for a couple of moments before we give you the answer. Why do you think that the prophets began most of their du'a with the word Rabbana, our Lord? Why not begin it, Ya Rahman, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen, all the most merciful, all the most merciful of those who show mercy? Why not begin it, Ya Hayyu, Ya Qayyum, all the ever living, the one who sustains all of his creation? Why do they begin Rabbana? Have a think about that as we go on to explain the meaning of the word Rabb, and see if you get the answer right when I give it to you in a couple of minutes' time, inshallah. In terms of the meaning of the word Rabb, generally in the Arabic language, the meaning of the word Rabb, as Ibn al-Athir, rahimahullah, said, he said that it means al-Malik, al-Sayyid, al-Mudabbir, al-Murabbi, al-Qayyim, al-Mun'im. He said it means al-Malik, the one who owns everything, the one who is the owner of everything in the heavens and the earth. So everything in the heavens and the earth belongs to Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah Azza wa Jal gives from his dominion to whomsoever he wants, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he may give a king a kingdom, but the kingdom that he gives to the king and the king belong to Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may give you wealth that you sustain yourself with, but that wealth that he gives you belongs to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this body that Allah Azza wa Jal has given you, and the health that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, belongs to Allah Azza wa Jal. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of everything and the owner of the dominion and the possessor of everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then this becomes particularly clear on the Day of Judgment. And this is why Allah Azza wa Jal says Maliki Yawm al-Din. Why does Allah Azza wa Jal not mention Al-Malik in a general sense? Why does he relate it specifically to the Day of Judgment, the Day of Recompense? Because on that day it will be clear that there will be no other kingdom, and there will be no other king, and there will be none of the kings of this world who will hold anything or have anything. لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ. Who will the dominion, the possession of everything belong to on that day? To Allah, the one, the subjugator, the one that cannot be resisted, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from the meanings of Ar-Rabb is As-Sayyid, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the master of everything, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who commands, and we are the one who obey his commands. From the meanings of Ar-Rabb is Al-Mudabbir, the one who controls the whole universe, and nothing happens in this universe except that Allah Azza wa Jal decrees it and allows it to happen. Jalla fi ula. So Allah Azza wa Jal is the Mudabbir, the controller of the universe. And if Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who controls everything, then how can we worship other than him, subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-murabbi, the one who brings up his slaves and nurtures them and gives them what they need in their lives and teaches them what they need to know. And you know the word tarbiyah, when you bring up your small child and you take that small child from being just a baby and you raise them up and you feed them and you look after them and you teach them. From the meanings of the word al-Rabb is al-Murabbi, that Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who brings us up, who nurtures us. All of our feeding and all of our sustenance comes from Allah Azza wa Jal. All the money that we have comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every blessing that we have comes from Allah Azza wa Jal. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that teaches us what we need to know, and that guides us to what we need to know, and that takes us to the straight path. And from the meanings of al-Rabb is that Allah Azza wa Jal is al-Qayyim, the one who provides and sustains his whole creation, and that nothing can sustain itself without the help of Allah Azza wa Jal. So nothing in this universe exists except that Allah Azza wa Jal is sustaining it and allowing it to exist. And that's why if we look at the difference between the life of Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah being Al-Hayy, the one who is all ever living, and we look at the difference between our eternal life in paradise, inshallah, our life in paradise and the life of the people in hellfire lasts forever. But it only lasts forever because Allah keeps us alive there. And if it were not for the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal kept us alive in paradise, we would not be able to live. So there is nothing that exists in this universe or that will ever exist except that Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who sustains it and allows it to continue to live, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah Azza wa Jal is al-mun'im, the one who blesses his slaves with blessing after blessing after blessing. The blessing of Islam, the blessing of your life, the blessing of your health. All of these are blessings that we don't deserve, but Allah Azza wa Jal keeps on blessing us with them. And all of this is found within the name Ar-Rabb. And in reality, if all of these things are found within the name Ar-Rabb, then every name of Allah Azza wa Jal is found within the name Ar-Rabb. And Ar-Rabb refers to the rububiyyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the lordship of Allah. And this is the meaning of lordship. This lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these beautiful names and attributes, and these beautiful actions, and this beautiful description of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of it is contained within Ar-Rabb, the Lord. And now we come to the issue of why the prophets would frequently use this name in dua. That is because the lordship of Allah Azza wa Jal is of two types. There is a general lordship, that Allah Azza wa Jal is the general Lord of everything. And everything we mentioned, generally it applies to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his whole creation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord and the Master and the owner and the one who blesses and the one who raises up and nurtures his entire creation. But if we look at the difference between the way that Allah nurtures and teaches and brings up the believers, and the way that Allah blesses the believers versus the way that Allah blesses the disbelievers. And don't think that Allah doesn't bless them. Allah showers them with blessings. From the greatest of those blessings is that Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't immediately take them to account for their disbelief. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them time. Perhaps some of them will be guided by His permission, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if we look at the guidance and the nurturing that Allah Azza wa Jal gives to the believers versus the nurturing and the guidance that Allah Azza wa Jal gives to others, then we see that there is a particularly special kind of lordship. And that is the nurturing and the teaching and the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to the believers over those who do not believe. Some of the ulama of Islam, the scholars of Islam, they say that this is why the prophets would call upon Allah Azza wa Jal, Rabbana. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose those prophets over everyone else. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nurtured them in a special way over everyone else. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them in a special way over everyone else. And so reminding them of that blessing And thanking Allah Azza wa Jal for it, they would call upon Allah Rabbana, the one who chose us, the one who nurtured us, the one who taught us and preferred us over all of the rest of his slaves. And Allah Azza wa Jal knows best. We'll take a short break, and after that, we'll be back looking at the other names of Allah Azza wa Jal, Ar-Rahman and Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum. Until then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق.
Book of Allah is the foundation of Islamic civilization and the way out of every trial. Every generation of Muslims needs to develop a relationship with the Quran. So join me, Riyaz Ansari, for Reflections on the Quran.
Explore how the Quran has a wondrous impact on those who receive it as a book of guidance in Reflections on the Quran with Riyaz Ansari. Every Friday at 11 p.m. and repeat telecast at 12 p.m. Saudi Arabia on Peace TV.
Muhammad, peace
pearls of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Narrated Sahal bin Saad, may Allah be pleased with him. I heard Ibn Az-Zubair, who was on the pulpit at Makkah, delivering a sermon saying, O men, the Prophet, may peace be upon him, used to say, if the son of Adam were given a valley full of gold, he would love to have a second one. And if he were given the second one, he would love to have a third. For nothing fills the belly of Adam's son except dust. Sahih al-Bukhari, Volume 8, Book of Softening of Hearts, Hadith number 6438.
Every action depends upon its intention.
Intention sincere.
What is your intention? Why do you do what you do?
Concentration, focus, dedication, dynamic.
Every single aspect of your mind, of your soul, of your heart, is it for Allah, sincerely for Him? Or is it for something else?
Get going on how to improve your prayers.
The purpose of these talks is to counter exactly that type of behavior.
Join Abdulrahim Green.
In other words, with the outward action, there is also an inner dimension.
In Inner Dimensions of Worship, next on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters, welcome back. We're talking about some of the most important of the names of Allah Azza wa Jal. We've spoken about the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rabb, and now we come to speak of the name of Allah Azza wa Jal, Ar-Rahman. And Ar-Rahman is another comprehensive name of Allah Azza wa Jal that covers all of the meanings of those names that give us hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of those names that give us hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And hope in Allah azza wa jal is a fundamental pillar of the Muslim's worship. We mentioned previously that a Muslim's worship is based upon three pillars. It is based upon the love of Allah azza wa jal, and it's based upon hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's based upon fear of Allah azza wa jal. As for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we find it in the statement, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praises to Allah, Lord of the worlds. And how can you not have the highest form of love for the one who has nurtured you and supported you and given you your existence and your life and continues to shower his blessings upon you? Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. This gives you the hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maliki Yawmiddin, and this gives you the fear of Allah Azza wa Jal. So you base your worship upon three pillars, the love of Allah Azza wa Jal, hope in Allah's mercy and in Allah's reward, and a desire for paradise, and a fear of Allah's punishment and the hellfire, and those names of Allah Azza wa Jal that inspire fear in the believers. And we have to have all of these things. If you are deficient in any of them, like those people who say we worship Allah for love, but we don't want paradise and we don't fear the hellfire. This is not how the prophets were, and this is not how Allah Azza wa Jal commanded us to be. Rather, we want the reward that is with Allah, and we fear the punishment that is with Allah, and we love Allah Azza wa Jal over and above anything and everything else. The name Ar-Rahman indicates the all-encompassing mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A mercy that encompasses every single thing. And as for the difference between Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, then there are two mainstream opinions that the scholars of Islam put forward, or perhaps the two strongest opinions that the scholars of Islam put forward. The first is that Ar-Rahman refers to the general mercy of Allah. Like we said, with the name of Allah Azza wa Jal, Ar-Rab, the Lord has a general meaning that Allah is the Lord of everything, and that Allah particularly gives a special nurturing and a special blessing to those people who He guided. Likewise, some of the ulama divide Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. That Ar-Rahman refers to the mercy of Allah that is general over all of the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah Azza wa Jal sent only one part out of 100 of His mercy to the earth, and all of the mercy that you see on the earth is because of that one part that Allah Azza wa Jal sent down. And they said that Ar-Rahim is specific, special mercy that Allah Azza wa Jal gives to the believers in the hereafter. That mercy that is not for the disbelievers. And this becomes clear in the hereafter. Whereas many of us may live happy lives, whether we are believers or not, in the outward sense, if not in the inward sense. But in the outward sense, we may live happy lives, we may be sustained, we may enjoy ourselves. When it comes to the matter of the hereafter, the believers are given a special treatment that the disbelievers are not given. And the disbelievers are not benefiting from the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal when the matter is settled and they are put into the hellfire. But the believers are the ones who are having that special mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a strong opinion, but there are some ayat in the Quran, or there is an ayah or two in the Quran, that give us an impression that this might not be always true. And one of them is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah Azza wa Jal is Rahim to all of mankind. And some of the ulama of Islam, and this in my opinion is the correct opinion of the difference between the two, is they say that Ar-Rahman refers to the general mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, to the attribute of mercy. And Ar-Rahim denotes that Allah Azza wa Jal bestows that mercy. So Ar-Rahman is describing the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, the attribute of mercy that is a permanent attribute of Allah Azza wa Jal, that He is always described with and always has been described with. And Ar-Rahim refers to the bestowing of that mercy, that Allah bestows it upon whomsoever He wills, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah Azza wa Jal bestows it upon whomsoever He wills. So He bestows it upon some and not upon others. And He bestows in different levels to different people. So the mercy that Allah bestowed upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not like the mercy that Allah Azza wa Jal bestowed upon the disbelievers in this earth. And the mercy that Allah Azza wa Jal bestowed upon the believers in the hereafter is not like the mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon the disbelievers in this life, or indeed upon the believers in this life, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Moving on, so that we are able to cover all of the names that we want to cover, from the most comprehensive names of Allah Azza wa Jal, and from the names that the scholars of Islam considered or put forward as a possibility of being Allah's greatest name, is Al-Hayyul Qayyum. Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum. And Al-Hayy refers that Allah Azza wa Jal is the ever-living. And if you look at this name, you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the most perfect form of life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never dies. Because the one who lives and dies has life, but it's not a perfect form of life. We have life, but we die. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no need of anyone else. We live, but we need others. We need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need, after the help of Allah, help from Allah's creation in various different things. We don't survive by ourselves independently of everything else. If you look at the life of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah azza wa jal does not sleep nor does he rest. Again, a human being can be alive, but you sleep, you rest. You know, you have times when you're not awake, you have times when you're not concentrating. None of this applies to Allah azza wa jal. And all of the attributes that relate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in himself are encompassed by the name Al-Hayy. All of the attributes that refer to Allah Azza wa Jal in himself are encompassed by the name Al-Hayy. And as for Al-Qayyum, then Al-Qayyum is that Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who sustains all of his creation, and that none of his creation can live or be sustained without him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the universe only exists because Allah Azza wa Jal continues to sustain it and to allow it to exist and to take care of it and to control the matters that happen within it. And if this were not the case, then the universe would not exist. We already mentioned that our life in Jannah, even though it is eternal, it is not a complete life, even though it's eternal without death. Because the only reason we are alive in paradise is because Allah Azza wa Jal keeps us alive. As for the life of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah Azza wa Jal does not rely on anyone, does not need anyone. Allah is the first and there was none before him, and the last and there will be none after him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And awwal wal akhir. All of these names are found within Al-Hayy. As for all of the names that involve Allah Azza wa Jal bestowing upon his creation, bestowing his mercy, Ar-Rahim, the one who bestows his mercy, or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who provides, Al-Mun'im, the one who provides for his blessings for his creation, or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who takes them to account, or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that blesses them, or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that nurtures them or sustains them, all of these meanings are found within the name Al-Qayyum. And so if you put together Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum, like the word Ar-Rab, like the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within it. So all of the names come within this. And so if you look at any of the names of Allah, the names are either talking about something that Allah Azza wa Jal does to his creation, in which case they are encompassed by Al-Qayyum. Or they're talking about something that Allah is within himself. That Allah is the first and the last doesn't relate to something that Allah does to his creation. But it relates to a description that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for something that Allah Azza wa Jal does towards his creation, the actions that Allah Azza wa Jal does, these actions, the meaning of them is contained within Al-Hayy as well as Al-Qayyum. Because the name Al-Hayy, if you look at life, imagine a man who is in a coma. He's alive, but he's in a coma. He doesn't do anything. He doesn't have any actions. He doesn't talk and he doesn't move and he doesn't do and he doesn't do anything at all. He's in a coma. You wouldn't say this person has the most perfect and complete form of life amongst human beings. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. And Allah Azza wa Jal has the best example. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his life, this includes that Allah Azza wa Jal has actions that he does. We don't compare Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a man in a coma. Allah Azza wa Jal has actions that he does, mercy that he bestows. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rises above his throne. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the heavens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes care, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nurtures his creation. And this is part of his name Al-Hayy. Because the most complete form of life necessitates that Allah Azza wa Jal must have actions that he does. But these actions themselves are contained within the name Al-Qayyum. So if you look at all of the names of Allah, you either find something that is a description of Allah Azza wa Jal and it doesn't contain an action, or something that contains an action and these are found within the name Al-Qayyum. So in this episode, what we've done is to look at some of the most important names of Allah Azza wa Jal. After the previous episode in which we looked at the meaning of the name Allah, which is bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, and Allah knows best, Allah's greatest name. So we have looked at Ar-Rabb, the Lord, and we looked at Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, and we looked at Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum, the most merciful, the bestower of mercy, the ever-living and the sustainer of all of His creation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then that's all we have time for. Until next time, I leave you in the care of Allah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allah, Allah, You are my Lord, I bow to You. Allah, Allah, You are my Lord, I bow to You.